9092 Green Street in Reading, Massachusetts, as a four-family dwelling. We've already called this meeting to order once, so I guess the one thing I'll add is if there are folks here that aren't sworn from the prior hearing that would like, think they would like to offer any testimony is under oath, taken under oath here. If you think you're going to have something to say during a public comment portion, please stand and be sworn. Raise your right hand, please.
Peter Sandberg's Phoenix, I'm sorry. Peter Sandberg's Phoenix Architects.
Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you may want to speak, please stand and raise your right hand. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is I do. Thank you.
David, can you just have everybody sign in also?
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you, Kim. Yeah, if you are here in the audience or as a member of an applicant, please sign the sign-in sheet so our recording secretary can acknowledge who is here and present for the hearing. That'd be great. Thank you, Kim, for keeping me honest. We'll go ahead and open the floor up to the applicant.
Thank you. My name is Brad Latham, and I get nervous when I see the only dad on the agenda. We sat at 7 o'clock at night, so it could be a long night, right? Tom Bergendahl is with me. He was here before. It's been quite a while since we had our last session of the public hearing. Matt Langus, who's a project architect, as well as Peter Sandorsey from the same firm, are also here tonight. I had left with you, with the office, fairly recently, a copy of the revised plan and a letter that explained what the revisions were. If I could take a second to go through those and make them part of the record of the proceedings. At the last session, the board had certain concerns and actually had some specific thoughts that you shared with us. Based upon those, we asked for a continuance to be able to go back and try and address those concerns. So the plan was dated 12/6/2016 that was submitted, and I asked it be submitted tonight formally, shows the changes that we have been responsive to the various comments that we heard. If you recall, specifically, one of the items was parking. The prior plan showed 6 parking spaces. As you rightfully pointed out, we had to have 2. This is the townhouse design. So it's been redesigned, so there are actually 9 parking spaces, 2 for each unit, except one that actually has 3 because of the length of the driveway itself. So that actually conforms to the zoning requirements of the town. Front yard setback, the building as it now stands is 7 feet from the front lot line. The suggestion was to move that back farther. That's been moved back, so it's now 20 feet. An observation I made in that regard is that if you look at the houses in that section of Green Street, they're all very close to the street. So, and moving the building back is either consistent with those or farther back than moving the houses along that section of Green Street. The next item was lot coverage. The plan is shown before at 32.3% lot coverage. Zoning system actually was 25. That's been significantly reduced to 26.7%. And the chart, I believe, on the plan explains that difference. It's a significant reduction. It's 1.7% from the requirements of zoning. So it's a small variation. The reason we didn't go down to 25% is the configuration of the building. That last 200 somewhat square feet would have a significant impact upon the visual appearance and usability of the building itself. And the architects are here can answer specifics with reference to that, but it's very close to not even needing a variance in that issue. It's slightly over that amount. A couple of comments, if I could. The impact of this change, the original plan in some extent, but also was further refined, enhances the site distance of the intersection. If you go down Green Street or down Elliott Street, right now it's obstructed by buildings and by a lot of vegetation on the corner. This plan would pull that back and give much more intersection site distance. I think the redesign is suggested by the board and is shown in this most recent plan is going to be an enhancement to both this property and frankly would be a significant upgrade to that section of Green Street, thereby increasing the value of other properties in that area. By having this townhouse design located there. And I think it also improves the quality of housing in town by 4 units. There are currently 5 units there. The One, as we discussed, is not being used because of inadequate second means of access. The historic has been a 5-unit building. The proposal is calling for 4 units, and it will be a much better quality housing than currently exists in that site under the current condition. And I think the height issue I'd like to mention in passing again. This is in a district that the housing could be 40 feet high. The redesign is actually a little over 28 feet. So it's very much a single-family nature and character. It's a low-rise, low-impact type of design, and also it's an attractive design to the property itself. So I think those are, if I could, the comments we wanted to make on the changes that were made based upon the comments of the last session. And also, of course, of the last session, we saw the analysis of the last steps, and we heard those and we agreed on those. So we're more than happy to answer any questions you may have as far as the comments. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Frank. Given what we've heard regarding the new updated proposal from the applicant, I think it's appropriate to entertain any board members' comments related to the application. And Bob, why don't we start with you, if you would.
Sure. Okay, looking at the plan, Attorney Latham's letter here, it appears that, you know, three of the concerns certainly that we were talking about at the October meeting? Yeah, October meeting.
October 6th.
Yeah. Been, I don't know if you'd say taken care of, but certainly they've been visited by the applicant, and considerations for our comments have led him to undertake some changes to it, being the parking, obviously, was the one. Now, Bradley, the parking is going to be one in each garage.
Yes.
And one in the driveway, then, is the off-street parking, one in each driveway. And I assume you had one unit that had 3 spaces, you said.
That's correct. That's the one that actually enters on Elliott Street.
That's the one off of Elliott. You could park 2 cars, stack parking in that driveway. Maybe, or I guess you could use one in the turnout there, but that looks like it's the turnout for coming out of the garage, maybe, too.
That's correct.
But whatever, they can get them off the street in the winter for plowing purposes, etc.
That's correct. And that's actually more off-street parking than exists now.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And the front yard setbacks, we've gone to, looks like a minimum of 20 feet on that middle unit there that fronts on Green Street. Required is 30 feet, though.
Right.
As noted on the table. A40 district, yeah, with multifamily housing requires the 30 feet. And the same thing with the rear yard setback. It would require 30 feet, and we have 14.9 or 15 feet basically from one corner, 14.9 in the other. So about 15 foot there, so only about half of it. Side yard, we've made it in all cases. And let's see, the area wise, that's right, 40,000 is required, and we only have 12,368 in this particular lot.
That's correct. And of course, if I may, one comment there is it's in the A40 district. There are 5 units there now on that same lot, so the lot's not changing at all.
Right.
So while I agree, it doesn't conform to the current requirements, whether we do anything or not, that stays the same.
Right, right.
The use
it does. The lot is what it is. Yeah,
that's
the
correct.
Area, on that. As I'm looking through a question that I have, because I'm looking at your new plan here, and I see it looks like you have a couple of conifer trees there on the corner of Elliott and Green that are noted to be removed. Is there any plans for landscaping on this lot? I didn't see any mention of it, and I didn't see anything on the plans.
There was, I think we just put a passive comment the last session in October, is that this requires site plan review of the CBDC. So absolutely, there'll be extensive landscaping that takes place. The suggestion of removal of those conifer trees are the fact they are overgrown and obstructed in the section. And the feeling was that an extensive landscaping plan, if CPDC approves it, which would have to go to them, would show an attractive configuration to be consistent with the structure. Frankly, if you want us, if you are inclined to grant us relief, want us to come back and show you what we've done with CPDC approval, we're more than happy to do that.
Okay. Okay. And it makes sense to me that CPDC would handle that aspect of it if, in fact, they do have to visit CPDC on this and get their approval. Yeah. I questioned the last time a shed in the back there. What was going to happen to that? Now, I see you've noted to be removed, and I think the last time you noted the shed was to be removed up in that, northwest corner of the lot, and I still don't see anything on that. No notes on it that it's to be removed.
You're correct. I don't think we probably communicated with the surveyor. That's probably our fault. We have no problem if you want to impose a condition that that be removed if you want to remove it.
Okay. And let's see. Now, what's just in front of the shed, I'm looking there, it looks like there's another structure where that dimension, the offset line from the corner goes through there. What is that structure? I can't recall myself. See right in
the... Right there?
Rectangle, is a concrete... Yeah.
Let me see that.
Yeah, right here. Yeah, it looks like a...
I don't know
if it's a structure or a concrete...
It's not a structure, yeah.
But whatever it is, it will be removed. We don't think it exists.
Yeah, okay. We don't know what that is. But that's one thing. If I think if we're going to be giving up, if the board so is inclined to deal variances in regards to the back to the rear yard setback, and now it's at 15 feet, I think it would be good for the abutter to the north if that shed were removed. And I know that the existing garage there that kind of is what, about 3 or 4 feet from the property line, and that's being removed too. I think it would make sense to just kind of clean up that area there for the abutter.
That's fine. I also, if I may, envision that CPDC will require some sort of perhaps a solid fencing.
Oh, right.
Top
okay.
of that.
Fire, yeah.
They'll look at the vegetation. If it's going to compromise the vegetation, they may not have a steward. Otherwise, I suspect they'll have a steward.
Good point.
Okay, that's about what I have, David.
Thank you, Robert. Kathy?
I don't have a whole lot to add. I was not present at the initial hearing, but I do note that you have responded to a lot of requests, and it does look as though it will be an improvement to the property.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. John, would you, Robert's already gone over a lot of that, what you're requesting for relief. Would you review again for the board that which you're asking for?
Yes. Some of this is a function of interpretation, but I'll go through that if I may. The front yard, as was properly noted, zoning requires 30 feet. Currently is 7 feet. The end product is 20 feet. So we're actually making an alteration that's less non-conforming, or in one sense, I suppose, it's a variance. The second issue is the lot coverage. The variance would be of 1.7% to allow it to be 26.7 versus 25 on the lot coverage. The rear yard, some of the shed, as was commented, was 3 feet. The proposed location as relocated of the dwelling is 14.9 or 15 feet at the closest point. So that would be a variance from the 30-foot requirement. The last item is, I'm not totally clear on, is the gross floor area requirement. That's allowed 40% by the zoning bylaw. And it depends how you interpret that, whether we need a variance or not. With the reduced size in the building, if you include garages in that calculation, we're at 45%. If you exclude garages, we're below the amount that is the maximum. We're at 0.37%. Now, the reason I have a question whether garages are included, look at various definitions. it talks about dwelling, multifamily dwellings, it talks about the habitable area, the dwelling units within them. And it doesn't seem to include garages in the calculation. If you go and look at simply the definition of gross floor area, it seems to be exterior of the entire building, which could include garages. So it depends how one interprets that or reads the definition. So if you read it that garages are not included, no variance is required. If you read it that the garages are included in the definition of gross floor area, then we need to have relief because it's 5% over the amount. And I think that's everything.
That's all I have questions for right now.
Okay. Thanks, John. Si.
What did you say the gross floor area is now without the garages? You just said the 30. It's under 40.
Let me see if I can. It's is reconfigured. The new smaller size is 5,640 square feet if you include the garages. That's actually 45%.
Right. Well, if you exclude the garage.
If you exclude the garages, no variance is required. It's under the 40%, which is.
Because the last time with the garages excluded, it was 43%, if
that's
I remember.
Correct. Yeah, that's correct.
So you've knocked it down, I don't know,
4%.
4 or 5%, I don't know.
You're correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
All right. All right. I don't have any other questions.
Thank you, Si. Eric?
I had a question about the bedrooms. Is it correct that the assessor's card has it listed as 6 bedrooms for the dwelling right now? I think we're increasing that to 12, right?
How many bedrooms are in the building now?
And if you include the third floor,
right.
There are 2 bedrooms in that, so it's
okay.
2, 4, 6. It's 6.
Yeah. So we're going to double the bedroom size. And I know we kind of touched on it on the last meeting, but the only thing that I see from Glenn in terms of his concerns about the actual building itself is a second egress for that attic space. I just was wondering if you could just kind of map out kind of the hardship prong of the argument for the variance. I mean, if it was a special permit, I think it's an amazing project.
Sure, sure.
It's just a different, you know, criteria, obviously. And if we're gonna double the bedroom, I mean,
mm-hmm.
obviously, presumably you double the rent as well. So I just wanna maybe map out.
Sure.
Yeah.
It basically related to the life safety codes and the structural condition.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to ask if Matt or
yeah.
Peter want to recite what they said last
sure.
time.
Sure. I remember that, you know, there was some issues
right.
with maybe some buckling walls.
Yeah, there were. This is the board from, I believe, the last meeting as well, where we addressed some of the structural implications, life safety issues,
mm-hmm.
Significant cracks in the foundation, some structural implications with this rear wall, which is where the most of the gable is sitting, is actually bowing out to the left. Life safety concerns are the stairs, the width of the stairs would need to all be increased to 42 inches. I believe they're all at 32 right now. So the alteration level would be a level 3 because we're changing more than 50% of the building. All of the 4-inch walls would either need to be replaced with 6-inch walls or use foam insulation. The walls, the ceilings, and floors are all undersized based on today's current IBC codes as well. And they would also need to be replaced or sistered with new studs and joists based on today's codes and today's loading based on our structural calculations. The rear wall in the foundation is cracking towards the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And both of those photos, some of the roof area on the main house as well as the house the portion of the roof that wraps around the side here is showing water damage and rot as well as cracking. So there's a significant amount of damage that's done to the existing building, and we're trying to, you know, do a new foundation, correct shear wall bracing, and address all the egress and life safety concerns in the proposed building.
Now, is it more expensive than tearing it down and rebuilding a brand new structure? Or?
So we actually think it's, by the time you finish it, yeah, we think it's going to be more expensive because by the time we end up tearing out, I think, all of the floor, all of the basically the roof and every wall, we're going to be at the foundation regardless. So at that point, it's just the demolition of the foundation would be the only additional piece.
Want to have something on record about that. Thank you. All set.
Thanks, Eric. Nick?
I just have a question about the basis for the requested variance on the uniqueness and hardship. Now, this is originally a five unit building, right? And how many bedrooms are existing in these units right now? You know?
Six.
Six. And then with this new structure, what are the total bedrooms that are going to exist?
12.
So you're doubling the living space, essentially. Okay. The way I was looking at this was I was looking at the uniqueness as being a five family on that lot, and I was kind of relating that to the extent of the variance you could ask to build a similar structure and what leeway you might have in doing that. But what I'm trying to do is wrap my head around, like, you could do this with a special permit. Maybe you could do this within the restraints with the same number of bedrooms and the same number of units, even though you're going down a unit. So I guess maybe I'm trying to understand, you said there was about 260 or so square feet that prevented you from getting to the minimum size. Can you talk more about that?
I'm sure you repeat that.
I believe you said there was a couple hundred square feet that kept you from getting down to...
Yes, a lock to the 25%.
Yeah.
Yeah, perhaps could you address that? What the implication would be.
So I'll actually address that. When we started to shrink the building, we went into the floor plan and basically cut square footage where we could take it and still have spaces that function. So for instance, say we cut through the whole building here and take a whole foot out, and then we do it here, here, here. At a certain point, you can't take a garage that's less than 20 feet deep because you can't put a car in it. So we get that's what happens. We get to a point where we have stairways that don't work, garages that don't work. So there's a stop point.
Hardship there, okay.
Exactly.
All right. That's all I have.
All right. Thanks, Nick. The board members have addressed most of the questions that I had. You still have to go before the Board of Selectmen as well for a curb cut, don't you?
Yeah,
okay.
Correct.
So you've got site plan review at CPDC, Board of Selectmen for curb cut,
right.
I think we want to make clear for the record that we're talking about a building that is four units, and you're gonna essentially. That's what you're asking for. You're asking for it to be determined as four units under these new dimensional plans that you've provided. Am I understating that in any respect? I mean, the hearing notice says you want it determined to be a four-unit building.
Yes, I didn't draw that hearing notice, but basically, we are looking for a variance. To allow what is now a five or four, depending on how you look at it, unit building, to replace it with a new four unit building.
Okay. All right. That's all that I have. Other than other items that the board has raised, I think we ought to, before we move forward, go into perhaps some public comment. And then perhaps some final comments by the board before we. So I'm going to open up the hearing to any public comment. Is there any member of the audience that'd like to speak to this variance application? Going once, going twice. All right. We'll close the public portion of the hearing down. Are there any other comments that the board would like to make, John?
Well. In terms of the number of units in the building, I was able to pull from the folder the inspection, which is required by law, of anything over two family or two units within the same building. And that was done by Glenn, building inspector. And in it, he had mentioned that the fifth floor or the third floor, the fifth unit, is not a habitable unit. So we're really talking about, right. We're talking about basically four units within the building. So we're talking about four.
We weigh on arguing that point. The fifth unit has historically been a unit, but under the current code, you have to have a second means of egress, and it doesn't have it. So that would have to be constructed. But you're correct. So I mentioned five because historically it's been five, but right now it's lawfully four.
Well, I think, again, we've been through this a number of times. What is in the assessor's records and what is in the actual existence by code are invariably two different things. So in terms of what was there before, whether it was a fifth one there or not, whether the assessors were assessing you taxes on it or not, it was not a habitable unit. And that was determined by the building inspector. That's one thing. I had another question that I negated to ask, and that is, when we talked about this back in October, the board was talking or asking, what's the likelihood of shrinking the footprint of the resulting post structure? Did the final one, the final plan that you have given us this evening, actually shrink in size? And where was the shrinkage? Per unit? It appears to be, even though we don't have it here, because we don't have any documentation, but you, Brad, you mentioned that it's still 28 feet at the peak.
The new building.
The new building.
Is it 28 and a fraction? Just over 28.
At the peak.
Right. In fact, let me give you this information. Peter, do you want, Matt, you want to describe how you shrunk it?
Yeah, so I know it's the previous, I believe the previous width of the building was 40 feet. I don't have the old plans from the last meeting on me, but it's now 37 feet in full depth. And it was also 100 feet in the whole width, so there's an additional 3 feet taken out that way. And I think it ends up being roughly around 800 square feet that we've taken out. So a lot of the bedrooms, including these three, and some of the ones towards the back that are on the inside, are right about the 11-foot mark, the 10.5-foot mark. So it's just enough to fit a full-size bed and a nightstand on either side. So we try to take in, like Peter mentioned before, enough square footage out to hopefully make a significant impact on the coverage of the building, of the gross square feet, but also keep these units a three-bedroom unit and still have them be comfortable as well.
I've got a copy of the prior plan if you want to take a look at it.
I have that with me too. I just didn't know where the shrinkage was. It appeared to be smaller, just in the way it was positioned on the site plan. But I didn't know where it was coming from. The garages, I understand. The issue really comes down to the variance aspect of it and the request that you're making for the front yard setback, the rear yard setback, and I understand the front yard setback. It gives us a better streetscape, number one, but also sight lines on both sides, Elliott Street as well as Green. The floor area is a major discussion that we talked about before. It has come up a number of different times. The building inspector looks at gross floor versus net floor as being very questionable as how do you interpret, because it's not really defined in our bylaws. But I think in past times that you'd come before this board over my tenure on the board, garages were really never considered as part of habitable units. So taking out the garages really were more of a measure that would be consistent to net floor, not necessarily net floor area, but habitable area. Mm-hmm. I think the biggest issue here is you're asking for a variance. Variances nobody's guaranteed of a variance. No one's entitled to a variance. Certainly not going from a four unit structure to another four unit structure when you're changing anything beyond the footprint of the existing structure. That makes a big difference, and it's hard for I think any board to come up with that. However, in lieu of what you presented here, it appears, at least to me, that it's an improvement in the area. I like the fact that you're keeping it to 28 feet at the peak, because it's not going to overshadow the other homes in the neighborhood. It's certainly not going to fit right into the neighborhood, because I mean it's new versus old construction, but I mean at least that is a positive factor. The only thing that I'm a little bit concerned about is what happens during the time that you have the tear down and the building. I assume that that's going to be taken up with site plan review along with the process of getting the curb cuts and what the road commissioners, aka the selectmen, are going to require for sidewalks and all the rest of it. But initially I was not in favor of it because of the fact that you could get to the 25%, which would minimize the request that you're making. But the 1.7% is somewhat de minimis, but it's an issue that we still have to take up in the form of a variance. Do you meet the four criteria of the variance? So I'm just asking that as a question. I don't have an answer.
Well, I think that's a question for all of us to consider.
Exactly.
Yeah. Robert, did you have further comments to make?
I did. After you passed this out, Mr. Latham, I see we have a little insert here, lot coverage.
So that should actually say gross floor area.
Pardon?
That should say gross floor area.
Okay, so that's what I was confused at. This is a lot coverage, and then we got a table over here that's different.
Yeah.
So that's not really the lot coverage.
That
it's
gross
floor
area.
That's
right.
Of the existing house and the gross floor area. Now, is that counting the garages?
That counts the garages.
That counts the garages.
That's
so
right.
That's gross floor area and not lot coverage. Okay.
And again, the gross floor area of the proposed structure includes the uninhabitable space, the garage. That's the outside of the building envelope.
Right. If you exclude the uninhabitable space, we don't need a variance for that.
Okay. You know, that was basically it. And you know, I know the lot coverage is supposed to be 25%. We're dealing with a really undersized lot here, replacing the four units with another four-unit structure. And he's got it, according to his table, down to 26.7%. And I'm assuming that's pretty much what he could hold on, whether we could get it down to 25 or not, I don't know, and meet code, as they were saying, with stairways and corridor widths, depths of garages, etc., on that. So I think he's done a good faith effort in that regard anyway, getting it down to 26.7, whereas before it was, 32.3 on that. So he's dropped that 6% or so. Yeah.
Anything else?
That's
it, Robert?
Yep.
Any other comments from members of the board?
The only comment I would make is that the gross floor area that you were talking about before, I would have found unacceptable. I think you made a very good faith effort here to make it better, and the same comment applies to lot coverage, actually. You know, it's not 25%, but it's a lot better than it was.
Yeah.
All right. You know, I agree with comments from the board. I think, you know, while we're always helpful to make helpful to applicants to allow them to make decisions, our mandate here is to determine whether or not the applicant has met the four criteria necessary to grant a variance in the areas of, well, if we're claiming that, well, if we're going upon on the basis of gross floor area not requiring a variance, then we're going on lot coverage and setbacks.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, has the applicant demonstrated that they've been able to meet their burden as it relates to the four criteria necessary for a variance? And I think they've made a good run at it, and I think you know, we as a board, now just from the perspective of getting to a vote, Kath, you weren't here at the first hearing,
no.
So you won't be a voting member. It'd be Robert, John, myself, Cy, and Eric, who viewed the hearing remotely. And you need four out of five. So with that in mind, unless there are other questions or comments from the board, I would entertain a motion, since that's what the applicant's here for tonight, a vote. Anybody? Robert.
I'll give it a shot. Sure. Okay. I'll make a motion in regards to case number 16-18. 9092 Green Street, Reading, Massachusetts, for a variance, for variances, plural, that the board deems necessary under section 6.3 of the zoning bylaws in order to allow the use of the property located, again, at 9092 Green Street, to remain as a four-family dwelling, noting that the existing family or the existing structure is a legal four-family dwelling, and that the proposed structure would be a four-family townhouse type dwelling. Would you want me to go through the variances that are required in regards to?
I think that would be wise.
Yeah, I think we're talking, it looks like 6 variances. Height is not required for a variance, right. Lot size is existing at 12,368 square feet. What's required is 40,000 square feet. Variance required in that regard. Frontage.
Well, wait, yeah, I mean,
excuse me.
I'm sorry. I'm not sure that a variance.
That's
is.
That's not a variance. I don't think.
It's not. It's as existing.
It's grandfathered.
It's as existing. It's grandfathered.
Would be grandfathered. So I'm not sure that a variance would be needed for that.
Okay. Okay.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Robert.
I'm thinking as soon as you tear down the house, now you're dealing with an undersized lot. You're putting in a new building. New structure would require 40,000 square feet of lot area, and it's not there. I realize you're demoing one that's already on the house.
Probably because it's a tear down, include it.
Yeah.
Go ahead, include it. Yeah.
So
you're right.
Go ahead and include it. I don't think it would hurt.
No.
To do that.
Rather have it.
Have it than
not
have
need
it.
It than not
yeah.
have it. Yep.
So I think we should include that. Let's see. Frontage is okay. That's required is 80 feet, and it has 143.66. So we don't need a frontage variance. We do need one lot size. Maximum lot coverage is required at 25%, and the proposed lot coverage is 26.7%. So we're 1.7% over on that variance request. Front yard setback is required at 30 feet, and the proposed front yard setback is 20 feet. So we're shy 10 feet in that particular case. But again, that is one where we were even closer on the first rendition, and now we've moved it back to 20 feet, and I don't think you can get much better than that. So we got 20 feet for that request, a 10-foot variance request. Minimum side yard setback, 30 feet, and we're required 30 feet is required, and they're providing 30.5. No variance required there. And rear yard setback is required at 30 feet, and what's being provided is 14.9 feet minimum, approximately one half of that. So we have a variance request of 15.1 feet on that. So those are the, let's see, I have four variance requests in that particular case. You agree with that?
Mr. Chairman, if I may,
yep.
Could the board make a finding initially how it interprets the gross area? Because if you determine, make a finding, that in fact you do not include the garage in the gross area calculation, then no variance is required for that. If you determine that it is included, then I would ask that you include that as a variance.
Well, we're not, right now we're not including that, so we would have to define that because of the, as Brad mentioned, the differential of how it's interpreted, the finding would clarify that. That we're not asking for a variance on that. It's just
clarification.
I would.
Well, I think we would want to make a finding.
Yeah.
At the tail end, we're probably going to add some, at least one condition, if not several conditions. So as part of
Then I would say in the garage. So let me ask a quick question. Then is the garage is heated? Are they specifically heated?
We can have whichever way you want to not have any.
Or is it just residual heat that's in the garage?
I would think that'd be a good
criteria for habitable space or not.
It would not be heated. No.
They would not be heated. Okay.
So if they,
I think
if
that's a good argument that they would not be habitable.
Right. Sorry, we ripped your momentum up there.
Okay, so there's four variance requests for dimensional controls for variances. Now I could write that up that way. And again, the variances we can put conditions on. Obviously, we typically on these the petitioner shall submit to the building inspector certified plot plans of the proposed construction and proposed foundation plans prior to the issuance of a foundation permit for the work. And the petitioner's final construction plans for the new structure shall be submitted to the building inspector along with as-built foundation plans prior to the issuance of an actual building permit for the superstructure. And as-built plans showing the completed construction shall be submitted to the building inspector immediately after the work is completed and prior to the issuance of an occupancy permit. And the construction shall be in general conformance with the survey plan submitted, prepared by, Vineyard Engineering and Environmental Services, 400 West Cummings Park, Woburn, Massachusetts, dated December 6, 2016, and stamped by registered land surveyor James Abley, and in general conformance with the architectural plans submitted,
designed by Phoenix Architects, and I take it dated 1/5/17, 2017 here in the corner. Submitted tonight.
Do you want to make reference on this sketch that little note in the corner is?
Yeah, we should say as amended for the gross floor area.
Oh, okay, yeah, as amended in the upper left corner, that lot coverage should be deleted and replaced with the title gross floor area. If anybody would like to add anything to that, it's kind of convoluted and lengthy, but
a couple of friendly amendments, if I might.
Yep.
One is that we add a condition that we discussed earlier regarding the removal of the shed and any other outbuilding, if that dot in the corner happens to be an outbuilding.
Right.
That the shed is removed, and perhaps add in that we make, I guess, the first finding that we should make as a board, that the granting of a variance is based upon a finding that the board feels that the applicant has met the four criteria necessary to obtain a variance, and a finding that the board has calculated gross floor area minus the garage or uninhabitable space. I'm not sure how we want to word that specifically, but at least minus the garage in this case, which gets them under the threshold.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we just say unheated garages?
Unheated garages, yeah, minus the unheated garages.
Right.
Do we need anything subject to? Because we're talking about curb cuts with the Board of Selectmen, we're talking about CPDC.
Yeah, also probably, do we want to make those conditions or
findings?
I don't think we'd make them a finding.
No.
Probably conditions.
Yes. I would think that it should one of these other entities find that there needs to be an adjustment to the variance that was granted. Needs to return to the board, but I think that the board needs to come back because of the site plan involvement.
So subject to CPDC site plan approval, subject to approval of the road commissioners, Board of Selectmen, for the one additional curb cut, Brad? Is that just one?
I'm not sure whether they consider it 1, 3, or 4. It's wide open right now.
All right, so subject...
On both sides of the street, right? Both Elliott and Green.
Subject to the approval,
approval of all curb cuts requested by the road commissions. I think that's the only... Those are the only two boards they're going to need to see.
I think right now, yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Unless you perceive something else, Brad.
No, I think you've covered it.
Okay. All right. Let's let Robert catch up.
Mm-hmm.
We've given him a mouthful.
Yeah, that's road commissioners and the Board of Selectmen.
Well, yeah, it's one and the same.
One and the same.
Yeah, one and
okay.
the same.
Slash. Yep.
So CPDC and the Board of Selectmen.
Right. I have that. Subject to CPDC approvals and subject to approvals for curb cuts as recommended by road commissioners / Board of Selectmen.
Okay. All right. I think we got it covered. I think we do. Okay. Not going to make you repeat that.
Yeah.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. Second by Cy. Any further discussion on the motion on the table? Hearing none, we'll take a vote. Again, Robert, John, myself, Cy, and Eric. All those in favor? Opposed? Hearing none, the variance is granted unanimously 5-0.
Thank you very much for your time. We appreciate it.
Hang around, Brad. I'll stamp some drawings and plans for you, and we'll get you on your way. Thank you.
latest plan?
Yeah, I think it was.
Sure, it's last week, maybe this week?
Yeah.
You don't have any stamps, so it's hard to.
Is it the 14 days to, well, typically, we'll have it done before 14 days, anyway, right up. And then there is a 20-day appeal period, and then it must be filed with the registry of deeds.
At least see Brad. Going back up in some semblance of order here for you. All right. There you go. Thanks, Brad. Good night. All right. Thank you, Robert.
No problem.
Thank you for your patience while we worked through getting that right.
Yeah. It was a little lengthier than most of our requests for meetings.
That's for sure. We don't have anything else on the agenda. We haven't seen anything in terms of updates on the Reading Village 40B. We've got another new 40B coming down the pike.
Right.
That we will open a hearing, I think, on
February
2nd on the St. Agnes Woburn Street property. That's a 20-unit, proposed 20-unit.
We do have something I saw scheduled, but just a brief, something Arlington Street for February.
Right, yeah. I saw that on the, yeah, not, there's been no.
I will not be able to attend the meeting on the 16th of February.
Okay. All right.
I will be out of town.
Okay, we'll make a note of it. For the applicant, and we'll double check to make sure that we'll have a full board.
So if you make note of that, Kim, and let Maureen know too, if you would, yeah, thank you.
I've been invited to a meeting in the Public Services Department to discuss some perceived ambiguity in, or whether or not there is a perceived ambiguity in the current zoning bylaw as it relates to the by right conversion slash demolition and rebuild of properties that can be by right converted from a single to a two family, because they meet certain, the properties meet certain conditions, criteria. Following closely on the heels of a recent case that we heard where a developer wanted to bypass the conversion part and go right to demolition and rebuilding a single as a two. And so town staff have asked me and the chair of the CPDC to attend a meeting, I think it's January 24th, to go over or discuss whether or not that should be changed to either make it less ambiguous or make it, I don't know, easier, less onerous, less confusing, less questions asked, apparently, staff,
so
town staff.
Town staff is confused over this bylaw.
It appears there's some the comment in the bylaw that governed that situation or that scenario seems open to interpretation in their view. And I'm not sure whether our interpretation is one that town staff is in favor of or not. So we'll perhaps learn more about that on January 24th and see if the bylaws to be changed, it would need to be changed via open meetings, open hearings, and town meeting. So this is but the first foray into asking questions as to whether or not a change is needed. So I'll keep everybody posted as necessary on that. You have something, John?
Yes, could I? We have been talking about this for some time now, especially in the past year or so, and that's delivery of plans the day before a hearing or whatever. I believe that the board has, with the town clerk,
a list of procedures to follow in the process. I looked at our application. It's the procedure for the application is here, but the method of going through that in determining where those plans, the 10 copies of the plans and everything go, is not. I think that's in the actual procedure that we formulated, well, I'm going to say at least 10 years ago.
At least.
And that was more or less an upgrade of something that preceded that by another 10 years. But part of that was, should an applicant not adhere to presenting sufficient sets of plans to the board, then the meeting or the hearing schedule would be either continued or modified until that material was given to the board. I don't remember, unless you can remember, Bob, if it had indicated a particular time, but I know that we always used to say that it needed to be here a week prior to the hearing date, which would make us...
Yeah, I don't know. I can't recall if it's written down anywhere or...
I think it was supposed to be listed. We had to go over procedures. Yeah. This was way back when. And there were always procedures with town clerk, but I don't know where that is right now. So the only... I would assume that Kim could do some work for us in that respect.
Well, that's what I was thinking. I mean, perhaps we could just echo or try to enforce the timing of it, I mean, to the best of applicant's ability in some situations. But, you know, perhaps have some sort of caveat warning that because of late submissions, the board may choose when you show up for a hearing to continue the hearing based upon having incomplete information or your failure to meet deadlines, perhaps. I mean, you know.
Which could impact the time frame on the 40A requirement to hear the petition.
Right.
I mean.
Yeah. There's a domino effect.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right. But I think at least let's start with maybe having town staff try to be our enforcer on that front, to the best of their ability, obviously, and see if that bears any fruit.
Who sets that kind of a ground rule anyway? Can we even do that?
Yes.
Well, yeah, I mean,
I can. That,
for example, you know, there will be no hearing on an issue in less than 7 days.
CPDC has a list.
Huh?
CPDC has a list. If they want to be on the agenda, they have to submit it by a certain date or they don't get on it. Maybe you guys should, like, create that list or see if Julie can use the same list and say if you want this, if you want a variance, it would need to be set by, like, 3 weeks before, so everything has to be in 3 weeks before. Yeah. They're not on it.
Yeah, and it wouldn't be on until the next, I'll say, the next available date.
Right.
Exactly.
Because
next
three dates may be filled up solid, right. And you may not see them for 2 months.
Can you ask Julie if that's,
I will,
if that list would be
if we can
convertible to,
yeah, I will ask for
our
that.
Use? I mean,
yeah.
Seems,
yeah,
like let's not reinvent the wheel. If a process,
right,
is already in place, let's
one board
adopt
is using
it.
That, I think.
Right. We
should
adopt
all follow
it.
The same,
yeah,
policy.
We should adopt, yeah, it, presuming it's all
and
things
with,
being
with
equal.
With a series of 40Bs coming up,
yep,
we don't need to be pushed back and not meet the 180-day requirement because of incomplete sets of plans and whatever,
right,
changes.
Late
requests.
Submissions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of which, we all probably still have time to chime in on that 40B draft decision. I don't know if
mm-hmm.
board members have had an opportunity to spend any time with it. I have had a little bit. But we ought to get any proposed changes that we have, or at least substantive things, back to Julie, because the hearing is presumably going to close on the 19th. You know, we haven't heard back on the small peer review things that we've requested last time around. But I imagine that's probably in the works. You know, we're our first week back from the holidays. And we'll probably get it, the day before or the couple of days before, but we'll have it. They weren't earth-shattering. And then we ought to think about whether or not during that ensuing 40-day period to draft, to publish the decision, whether or not we as a board want to meet to discuss it at all, perhaps even with town council or town staff. So we ought to think about whether or not one or two meetings during that 40-day period are necessary to discuss the makeup of the decision and, you know, really narrow.
Should we be in a position that this January 19th session to discuss specific conditions that we think should belong in the decision? And not end up surprising.
Well, I think
the developer after it's in there, and we never.
Well, they've seen a draft decision that has conditions in it. If you want to add some conditions between now and the time we get together on the 19th, go ahead and do it.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, get them into the draft.
Relay those to probably David as the chair.
Send them to me. You can. That's fine. Or send them to Julie.
Julie. The thing is, you know, it's doing it that way. I mean, I may think there should be a condition which you might say, no, that's, I don't agree. Okay.
Well,
so I hate to see a condition go in there that we're not unified in.
Well, anything that might need to be, anything new that's added, we should probably discuss at the hearing.
Or if you just add it in, anyone who's added it in, it's a discussion point.
Or, you know, put an asterisk next to it, you know, suggested by Cy, suggested by Kathy, you know, and perhaps those will be the minimal points of discussions. I think that'd be a fantastic idea.
You're looking at me, John. You don't think?
No, I mean, reality says that if that is the last session, you're either granting or you're denying. And some of the issues, because you're not going to be able to discuss all the issues until we actually do it in a public hearing.
Right.
If we want to review in that 40-day period in writing the draft decision, the draft decision is only a guide for us to be looking at. It doesn't have everything. What is finally in that draft is what we, in talking about putting the actual conditions down during that 40-day period that we're writing it with, with again, perhaps the guidance and in the help of town council, either Gene or Julie, whatever. But I mean, I don't see how we're going to sit with a draft decision that's sitting out there with everything that's there. You're not going to be able to do it unless you're willing to do a 6 or 8 or 10 hour.
Well, we certainly don't have to nail down all the conditions before we close the hearing.
True.
We just, if there are, I still stick to my earlier statement. If you have changes or proposals to add into the draft decision, send them in. Mm. Let's have them there.
What I'm trying to avoid is that when you put the draft decision together and it goes into a public hearing, to me there shouldn't be any surprises in that draft that people have not heard about or has been discussed today. Shouldn't be any surprises to the developer.
That's true.
I'd be very upset if I was.
But I don't think there's anything earth-shattering that we already haven't shared with that applicant that we would condition for, that they already haven't heard from us, at least generally, if not specifically, number one. Number two, if we're going to add conditions that haven't been discussed at a prior public hearing, we're going to discuss them at one of those follow-up hearings that we'll have to discuss the makeup of the decision. And if somebody feels that those conditions might make the project uneconomic or challengeable by the applicant, somebody will try to talk us out of including them, or we'll have to, you know, really lay the groundwork for including such a condition. But I don't see, the developer will be allowed to be at those hearings.
Okay.
So I don't think there's any surprise to, you know, that we're foisting conditions or other information that's new on the applicant. They're going to be part of the open meetings.
Okay.
We just can't take any more testimony or any new information in after the close of the hearing. We can tweak the decision and talk about it, and if the applicant has questions, they'll be allowed to ask, but no new information.
Well, since our discussion on that 40-day period is going to be in an open hearing.
Right.
People can certainly come, but they can't interface with us.
Board discussion, town council discussion, town staff discussion, that's it, as to the makeup of the decision.
And you mentioned, I'm glad that you mentioned it, the developer, too.
Well, the applicant's, right.
The applicant is there because you're talking about, I mean, a big issue that has gone into the other large 40Bs have been the pre-construction, the tear down, the conditions that you're working under, how it's to be done. All that stuff needs to come in. It needs to be put in because it's a contract. It's a document, a legal document, as you would say.
Yep.
So all that needs to be worked out.
I would say.
We haven't talked about any of that stuff. But the engineering department, I assume the building inspector, the other people in there, that they need to address that. It needs to go into the final document. That's when you're doing it. The fact that is, when you grant the petition for the 40B, it's under what basic conditions? And you're right, the request that they're making for the waivers, that's the basis for it, but it's not the whole thing. It's not the complete contract.
So when do we vote on it? I know that the hearing closes at the next meeting, and then we write this up. But obviously we're not voting on it at the next meeting, otherwise we wouldn't be able to add conditions. So do we just vote on it sometime during that 40-day period, after we've kind of polished it up?
Technically, I think that you have to, when you close the hearing, you have to take the vote. That you're willing to grant the petition with the major following conditions. And then how town council tells us to progress after that, you're closest to town council. I mean, you can call him, we can't. Town council, ask town council how he perceives, if we do close it and take the vote that night, how he just perceives that we're going to move forward on developing this contract. Because it's not what Julie put in the draft decision. At least I don't perceive it's just what's in
there. I've seen it done a couple different ways. I've actually seen a vote taken just to close the hearing. Close the public hearing. I've seen it done that way. I've also seen it done, if we're going to make a motion that's going to have, it's got to include the waivers and any other major conditions, we'll be reading all night long.
That's what I'm talking about.
But I don't want to read it into the record that night unless I'm told to, because that's a work in progress. It's not been finalized. So I'll take my cues from town staff and town council. We'll get it done the right way, whatever the right way is. But in any event, we won't hear any further. The hearing will be closed as of the 19th, and then we start on a new one on February 2nd. So get that in. Get their 59H account opened up, and start some peer reviews. And
that's been done before too.
What?
Have back-to-back overlapping.
I know. Never a dull moment, right? All right. Anything else for anybody? I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Kathy, all those in favor? Thank you, everybody.
Yes.
It was great. Yeah, it was a good time. We'll miss it sorely.
Who didn't come? Who the hell was he?
Yeah.
That was good. It was a different venue.